On behalf of the Department of English, let me welcome you to this sixth lecture of Parlen 2021 being organized by the Department of English, University of Gorbango. We will start the proceedings, say 1 minute from now. Waiting for 3:30.
Certainly. Thank you. Thank you very much for having me. I hope that we have a good session today. I'm very happy to see you as well as the participants here. So let's hope that everything goes well. In case there is any glitch, in case my internet connection goes, which normally does not happen in office, but in case it does, I will reconnect using my phone, which I have done in the past. So. Just to warn you, yeah.
So, AB sir, it is 3:30 already.
So, Vivek, if you are ready and if Professor Chaudhuri permits us, we can start now.
Yes, I am ready.
Good afternoon, everybody. Good afternoon, good morning, good evening, wherever you are. On behalf of the Department of English, University of Gorbango, let me welcome you to this new session of the remote lecture series, Parle 2021. Today, it is the sixth lecture of this remote lecture series, and we are very happy to have in our midst Professor Rosika Chaudhuri. Professor Chaudhuri is the Director and Professor of Cultural Studies, the Center for Studies in Social Sciences, Kolkata. And today she is going to talk about a very, very interesting thing, you know, being the inhabitants of an erstwhile colony. We often hear about and read about, and students of English that we are really concerned with the spread of Western education, the 1830s, William Bentinck, Thomas Babington Macaulay, Raja Ram Mohan Roy. These are the names that occur and recur in our discussion. Now, what happened? Who represents? And how and why? All these questions have plagued us from time immemorial almost. So we are eagerly waiting to hear from Professor Chaudhuri today. And I'm really interested in learning from her, how she is going to connect the colonial educational system with the canon of world literature. So without further ado, let me now request Professor Chaudhuri to address us. The session is yours, madam.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Professor Bhattacharya, for getting in touch with me, for inviting me to speak here. I hope what I say will make sense. If not, we can discuss it in questions later. I'll try and keep to the time given to me. If I'm speaking too fast or if I'm going over time, then please let me know. So as you yourself have said so beautifully in your introduction, today's talk is titled Macaulay's Magic Hat, the Colonial Education System and the Canon of World Literature. But what you have highlighted, of course, is the connection. What is the connection between the colonial education system and the canon of world literature? Hopefully the talk will make that clear. Just to sort of sum up what I intend to be speaking about today, the role of English in the colonies, in fact, in every sort of British colony, I think, not just in India, but of course over here, has been understood largely as the impact of government policy imposed from above. So in India, Macaulay's Minute of 1835 has been universally blamed for the implementation of an alien language upon an indigenous population. The colonial Indian desire for English literature, however, if you look at the history books, if you look at the cultural sphere of the time, was a conflicted impulse, I think, that was deeply imbricated also in the creation of India's powerful modern regional languages. And in our case here in Bengal, of course, Bengali. In each of these languages, a movement towards the consumption and creation of world literature mediated through English manifested itself creatively and critically, I will try and show, from the 19th century onward. So, ruminations on the nature of the colonial education system to date still quite largely take recourse to the Foucauldian imperative of discourse creation within a power-knowledge nexus. The most alarming manifestation of this in studies of the Indian colonial scene, in fact, in almost anything to do with British India, is the continued and consistent recourse taken to Macaulay's infamous minute of 1835, which is said to have spawned, and here I'm using Macaulay's own words, which is often quoted back to us, which is said to have spawned, Macaulay said, quote, a class of interpreters, Indian in blood and color, but English in taste, opinions, morals, and intellect, unquote. This seems to me much like pulling a rabbit, or over here, a class of rabbits, out of a magic hat. This was and remains, though, a point of view not just prominent in post-colonial scholarship, but also internalized by intellectuals across the board, especially by Indians themselves. Contrary, I will try and show, to the evidence in both the historical and cultural spheres, which shows the forging of a powerful creativity often out of English, European, literary and cultural materials in Indian modernity, post-colonial Indian intellectuals in denial have struggled with the notion of a derivative discourse, succumbing to a cultural cringe caused by the potentially embarrassing reality of taking part in the creation of a modernity inalienably linked to the colonizer's cultural practices. Commenting on Partha Chatterjee's definition of the colonial modern and derivative discourse also, of course, as you know, the term is taken from Partha Chatterjee. But over here, commenting on the term the colonial modern, which is a term that taints the Indian modern with the whiff of colonial compliance, the writer Amit Choudhury pointed out, and I quote, probably one of the principal reasons that the word modern is problematic for Indians, that modernity remains in South Asia an unofficial and potentially embarrassing reality, in spite of being a hegemonic and foundational one, is its filial involvement with the colonial. For many South Asian historians today, the very terms early modern and colonial modern are inflected with a nostalgia for what never did happen or what might have, an indigenous homegrown modernity in whose narrative the problematic moment of colonialism never occurred. The secret utopian longing in India for another purer modernity possibly explains why we fail to engage completely with the implications and radical achievements of this one, unquote. This secret utopian longing for another purer modernity, an indigenous homegrown modernity in whose narrative the problematic moment of colonialism never occurred, is exactly what animates, for instance, well-known left intellectual Shomor Sen's description of the Bengali cultural inheritance in a line in a poem addressed to his fellow countrymen. We are Bengali. We have a Mir Jafri past. We are the fruit of Macaulay's poison tree. Mir Jafar, as you know, and I don't need to tell this audience, was the general who betrayed the last independent Nawab of Bengal, Siraj ud-Daulah, to the British General Clive in 1757 at the Battle of Plassey, enabling Clive to conquer Bengal and thus India. The class of rabbits pulled out of Macaulay's hat are here conceptualized as the poison fruit of Macaulay's poison tree, a class of betrayers in the context of Indian history and modernity. Yet, both historically and conceptually, such an understanding of the role played by this particular 1835 amendment to government policy in British India has been vulnerable from the start. Historically speaking, it is easy enough to show that Indians themselves had demanded and attended innumerable schools since the late 18th century that gave them an opportunity to learn English. In fact, very much like the picture today. Dissatisfied with these private schools, they then pressurized the government itself to facilitate an English education for their sons. As the Chief Justice Sir Edward Hyde East recorded, I quote him, "Many of the leading Hindus were desirous of forming an establishment for the education of their children in a liberal manner, as practiced by Europeans of condition," unquote. At a meeting in May 1816, famously, a group of Calcutta citizens debated with the Chief Justice on their ambitions and requirements. I quote, "When they were told that the government was advised to suspend any declaration in favor of their undertaking from tender regard to their peculiar opinions, which a classical education after the English manner might tread upon, they answered very shrewdly by stating their surprise that they had any objection to a liberal education, that if they found anything in the course of it which they could not reconcile to their religious opinions, they were not bound to receive it, but still they should wish to be informed of everything that the English gentleman learnt, and they would take that which they found good and liked best. That which they would find, that they found good and liked best." Calcutta already had many private schools catering to the demand for the language, a demand predicated on the base desire for profit, no doubt. If you had to deal with company officials and do business with Englishmen, you had to know some English. However, over here in 1816, it was precisely for, as they said, the education of their children in a liberal manner and to be informed of everything, they said, again I'm quoting, that the English gentleman learnt, that the Bengalis wrestled with the authorities to bring into existence and build with their own money the Hindu College, the first institute for higher education in the British Empire, in 1817, almost two decades before Macaulay's infamous minute. And here I'd like to also point out that the Hindu College was not an exception, as this period saw Indian initiative in the establishment of many other private schools dispensing a similar education established by either wealthy Indians or non-official Europeans in Calcutta at this time. Apart from the missionary schools, of course. Conceptually, too, the dangers of ascribing agency or instrumentality almost completely to British policy and opinion in the matter of colonial education denies the complexities of the colonial situation in more ways than one, distorting the picture irrevocably. While it might be entirely tenable, like Said, to study Orientalism and maintain that it had nothing to do with the Orient that was out there, or to say, like his pupil Gauri Vishwanathan, that, quote, "how the native actually responds is so removed from the colonizer's representational system," unquote, that it has no value in any study attempting to understand colonial education policy, it still remains that if we focus on British ideological intention alone, then we ignore the field of operation and Indian agency in the matter completely. The colonial education system was not constituted of colonial education policy alone, but involved a far more diverse and disparate group of players, without whom the entire picture cannot be seen. Approaching the subject of the colonial education system from the Indian side then, and assuming that it was jointly constituted by British policymakers, missionaries, non-official British educationists such as David Drummond or David Hare, as well as by Indians, often fundrolling many of the educational initiatives of this period, one is forced to acknowledge, as Ejaz Ahmed said some time ago in theory, that, I quote from him, "the history of sedimentations which constitutes the Indian cultural formation includes much besides colonialism per se." As he pointed out then, post-colonial theory under Saidian influence focuses on colonial discourse analysis alone. And when that happens, we are faced with the conundrum that, I'm quoting from Ahmed again, if we are constituted by colonialism, and only by colonialism, I will add, then the only discourse that really matters is the discourse of the colonialist, unquote. Although not addressing Vishwanathan's account of colonial education policy in India directly, Ahmed's argument in relation to Orientalism, that it is impossible to examine, quote, the history of Western textualities about the non-West quite in isolation from how these textualities might have been received, accepted, modified, challenged, overthrown, or reproduced by the intelligentsias of the colonized countries, unquote, is equally applicable still to not just studies of the colonial education system as a whole, always reduced only to the Macaulay moment, but to our understanding of India's multiple modernities themselves. The next section is called Reconfiguring Colonial Education in India. Studies of the role of English in the colonial education system of British India roughly fall into a fairly predictable pattern of opposing camps, represented by the pre-Scythian thesis of the now discredited David Kopp, who emphasized the role of British Orientalists in creating an Indian national consciousness through a renaissance of the arts and sciences in Bengal on the one hand, to the opposed camp supporting the Scythian argument of Gauri Vishwanathan, emphasizing the relationship between the institutionalization of English in India and the exercise of colonial power, the construction of the curriculum and the operations of domination and control. Holding absolute sway during the high noon of post-colonial studies after its publication in 1990, Vishwanathan's thesis and the general approach it flags have not, however, become less relevant with the passage of time. I would like to point this out. This is important because the operation of power in the circuits of publishing that determine academic curricula in developing countries, what are called developing countries, may have become global in its sweep in the neoliberal era, that is our present era. But the relationship of control and domination with regard to intellectual hegemonies persists in similar ways, even if methodologies of implementation may have changed in the present day, of course. No less than the celebratory tones of David Kopp, however, Vishwanathan's condemnation of British educational ideology and English literature's role in it is no less flawed, for its spotlight upon the instrumentality of the colonial agenda alone in her readings of the colonial scene. If Kopp is to be condemned for his tacit valorization of British educational policies when he credits British Orientalism for setting in motion the dynamics of Indian modernization, then Vishwanath too is accountable for the attribution to the British of the transformation of English literature in India into what she calls an instrument for ensuring industriousness, efficiency, trustworthiness, and compliance in native subjects. These are her words. Almost exactly echoing Macaulay's phrasing in the class of interpreters' comment, only from the opposite end of the stick, of course, she too sees, along with Macaulay, that British policy would be instrumental in creating a class of men molded by their colonial masters into compliant models of efficiency, industry, and trustworthiness. I'd like to add in an aside that in left circles in post-independence India, the term they would have used for such collaborators would be comprador. With regard to her opinion that, quote, it is entirely possible to study the ideology of British education quite independently of an account of how Indians actually received, reacted to, imbibed, manipulated, reinterpreted, or resisted the ideological content of British literary education, the salient point remains that it is still the study of the ideological content of British rule that remains of interest. Adding to what Ahmed said in the quote above then, if the colonized are constituted by colonialism alone, exclusive of any agency or volition or independent response, then, like he said, the only discourse that really matters is and remains only the discourse of the colonialist. If we were to assume that colonial education reconfigured the conception of literature along British and European lines, which is the traditional manner in which we read literary history, almost in all standard literary histories of Bengali literature, this is the model that you will find. So if we were to assume that colonial education reconfigured the conception of literature along British and European lines, following which this Anglophone legacy was in turn reshaped by Indians, we would be returning to the old model of impact and influence upon a colonized population that then produced a discourse of imitation and mimicry. What world literature studies allows us to do instead, however, is to historicize the development of the modern notion of literature worldwide, and to discover thereby, startlingly enough, that literature as a category was not much older in France than in Bengal. Speaking of the establishment of literature in the French context, Roland Barthes writes in, this is from Writing Degree Zero, that after the demise of the classical and romantic periods in France came the moment of the birth of literature. I quote from him, as soon as the writer ceased to be a witness to the universal, to become the incarnation of a tragic awareness around 1850, his first gesture was to choose the commitment of his form, either by adopting or rejecting the writing of his past, and necessarily, because this is historical, of course, the pronoun his. Classical writing therefore disintegrated, Barthes says, and the whole of literature from Flaubert to the present day became the problematics of language. This was precisely the time when literature, with a capital L, the word having come into being shortly before, was finally established, he says, as an object. And I'd like to remind you that he's speaking here of France, French literature. If literature is craft, or literature with a capital L, as Barthes puts it, is the process of the poet adopting or rejecting the writing of his past, then, as I've shown in my book on the creation of a modern literary sphere in Bengal called The Literary Thing, I've argued there, for instance, that in Bengal too, the process had begun exactly around 1850. Regardless that in the context of the Indian writer, the reading of the scene has been contaminated by the advent of colonialism. Bengal too saw the disintegration of classical writing such that the whole of literature from 1850 onward turned to the problematics of language. This process was defined for Barthes in the relationship the modern poets crafted of reconciliation with or aversion to objectified form. And this is what Barthes says, I'm quoting from him again. The whole 19th century, and again, Barthes, of course, is speaking of French literature. The whole 19th century witnessed the progress of this dramatic phenomenon of concretion. In Chateaubriand, it is still only a trace. Flaubert, to take only the typical stages of this process, finally established literature with a capital L as an object through promoting literary labor to the status of a value. Form became the end product of craftsmanship, like a piece of pottery or a jewel. One must understand, he says, that craftsmanship was here made manifest. That is, it was for the first time imposed on the reader as a spectacle. Unquote. In Bengal in this period, it is the poet Michael Madhusudan Dutt who was the singular architect of refashioning form to build a literature for Bengal that was commensurate with the desires of a modern world. Reshaping the literary language and forms he inherited with violence, Madhusudan's whole effort was exerted towards the destruction of structures of the past. And in that effort, form stood resplendent as the tool of creative action, transmuting the texture of literary Bengali forever. Whether it was in the larger-than-life image he projected of the poet as craftsman, his introduction of blank verse, the creation of the Bengali sonnet, or in his revolutionary and startling use of punctuation, breaking the old hold of Paya Chandon in Bengali verse. Startling use of punctuation, breaking up traditional metrical schemes in favor of direct and dramatic address, Madhusudan stood unaided in this period in his loneliness of style. Above all, Madhusudan understood himself to be a world poet, participating in world literature. His canon was not just inherited from the tales of the Ramayana. It was crafted out of the materials at hand and at his disposal. The literature of the world as it lay at his doorstep in colonial Calcutta. Giving equal valence to Kalidas and to Virgil, he emphasized again and again in pronouncements now famous in the history of Bengali literature, his wish to create literary works sculpted from his inheritance, like Borges in Argentina, of the entire European tradition. In an extraordinary passage in an early essay written in English, he had said, and now I'm quoting from Michael Madhusudan Dutta himself, "I acknowledge to you, and I need not blush to do so, that I love the language of the Anglo-Saxon. Yes, I love," and there's an emphasis here, "the language, the glorious language of the Anglo-Saxon. My imagination visions forth before me the language of the Anglo-Saxon in all its radiant beauty, and I feel silenced and abashed. I have heard the pastoral pipe of the Mantuan swain. I have listened to the melodies of gay Flaccus. I have heard of bloody Pharsalia and learned to love Epicurus. I am no stranger to the eloquence of fiery Demosthenes, of calm Cicero, to Livy, to sententious Thucydides. I have heard the melodious voice of him who sang of Ram like a kokil. I have wept over the fatal war of the implacable Kaurav and the heroic Pandav. I have grieved over the suffering of her, Shakuntala, who wore and lost the fatal ring. I have wandered with Hafiz on the banks of Rochnabad and the rose bowers of Masalle. I have moralized with Sadi and seen Rustam shedding tears. But give me the literature, the language of the Anglo-Saxon. Banish Pito, banish Bardolph, banish Poin. But for sweet Jack Falstaff, kind Jack Falstaff, banish him not thy Harry's company. Banish plump Jack and banish all the world. I say, give me the language, the beautiful language of the Anglo-Saxon." Unquote. One of the most vivid and extraordinary testaments to the colonial mind educated in English in 19th century India, these musings on language and literature combine the European classical canon and the ancient Indian canon, showing off his education in Western classical texts, his interest in the Sanskrit poet Kalidas and the Indian epics, his knowledge of the Persian poets Sadi and Hafiz, and finally and most passionately declaring his love for the English language above all. A remarkable indication of the sort of literary mind that came into existence in Calcutta by the mid-19th century. To say that such a creative genius was simply the product of a colonial education in English imposed from above by Macaulay would be to fall far short of the truth. Yet later historians and writers have either celebrated him for his turn from English to Bengali poetry as representative of the nationalist impulse, or dismissed him for too much Western influence on his work. Michael's affiliations in world literature show him to be, rather, an offshoot of the cosmopolitanism of a city that engendered a worldliness produced by a consumption of regenerated Indian literatures as well as world literatures in translation. The next section is called Constructing a Canon. So this is the canon part of the talk. If there was a canon being put into place in colonial Calcutta in the early 19th century, then that canon was not of Bengali Indian literature alone. The teachers at Fort William College had been printing Indian texts in Indian languages in Calcutta from 1800 onward with the help of Indian interlocutors. And of course, you are familiar with this history, I'm sure. The School Book Society too had been compiling the British canon for Indian students in textbook publications that were the first of their kind. In another first and perhaps singular instance, when D.L. Richardson published a selection of British poets in 1840 as a textbook reader for students in India, he added at the end of his anthology, this is an anthology of British poets, a selection of Indian poets writing in English from Calcutta. So he added to that fat book, D'Irozio, Kashi Prasad Ghosh, and the Dutts, including thereby his near contemporaries in Calcutta within the canon, a rare moment of inclusion in an otherwise divided colonial sphere. Wordsworth would not be taught alongside D'Irozio again in India until after Indian independence, when school English readers routinely inserted Indian poetry written in English alongside the British. Curiously, when the Bengali canon began first to be constructed in Calcutta in the early 19th century, it was, we must note, in the English language. When Kashi Prasad Ghosh wrote on Bengali writers in 1831 for the India Gazette, he was constructing a canon for the Bengali reader in much the same way that the Bengali poet Ishwar Gupta subsequently constructed a canon when he collected the fast vanishing materials of his immediate predecessors and published them first in his Bengali newspaper, the Sangbad Prabhakar, and then in book form in Kobi Jiboni in 1855. From mid-century onward, so remember what Bath said about 1850, from mid-century onward, both languages began to be used to collate and define the canon, all of which worked influentially together to formulate it and give it shape and substance. The leading writer of late 19th century Bengal, Bankimchandra Chatterjee's two influential English essays, these are A Popular Literature for Bengal, 1870, and Bengali Literature, 1871, were brief critical essays cum histories, which were of no mean significance to the newly educated classes reading them. Both started out as review essays. This was a time when the canon was being invented and put into place side by side with the first important modern works making their way into the public sphere. Thus, in Bengali literature, Bankim starts with medieval poets Mukundaram and Vidyapati, but very quickly comes to the present writers in Bengali, reviewing not only the work of immediate predecessors such as Madhusudan or Kaliprasanna Singho, but also straight-faced his own work, the works of a Babu Bankimchandra Chatterjee, the author of such works as Kopalkundala, summarizing his own work at great length in this article that was first published anonymously in the Calcutta Review. The fluid, excitable, and nebulous nature of the circumstances of the birth of modern Bengali literature becomes apparent from such instances. And although the story of the evolution of the language would not be complete for another 50 years, by which time both a firm conception of a high cultural Bengali and a demarcated space occupied by the academic professional would take over, the importance of this formative period lies exactly in the unresolved nature of many of the most important categories of analysis as these evolved over time. If in the early period the emphasis had been on a world literary inheritance, with Madhusudan and Bankimchandra both emphasizing the creative gains of a Western literary inheritance, by the turn of the 19th century, as the high nationalist Victorian period solidified into place in the Bengali public sphere, a far more conservative and xenophobic conception of literary inheritance was put into place by nationalists. Madhusudan's allegiances to all of European literature are legendary, but fewer realize that Bankimchandra too was a prominent exponent of the Anglicist school, having displayed no qualms in remarking in 1870 on the pleasure with which he turned to the Anglicist school of Bengali writers after having dealt with the Sanskrit school, whose writings, he felt, were full of tautology and a decade later, Aurobindo Shastri remarks that the astonishing and exponential growth of Bengali literature. Sorry, I can suddenly hear myself.
Yes, ma'am, carry on.
Sorry. Okay, thank you so much. It's very disturbing. You can't sort of concentrate on what you're saying if your own voice comes back to you. So sorry about that. So I was talking about Bankimchandra and the fact that he spoke about the Anglicist school of Bengali writers with pleasure, and the Sanskrit school he felt was full of tautology and bombast. A decade then, that was in 1870. A decade later, around the 1880s, Horoprasad Shastri remarked that the astonishing and exponential growth of Bengali literature from Madhusudan's Tilottama Sambhav onward was made possible by a situation more exciting than that of the European Renaissance. For in Bengal, it was not only classical Greek literature that was regained, but he said, and I'm quoting him, all of the hidden treasures of the East and West. For in our country today has arrived the literature of England, France, Germany, Italy, that of the ancient Hindus and Buddhists, and none are better equipped than young Bengal to take advantage of this variety of literatures for new creations. This is Horoprasad Shastri, unquote. Meanwhile, Bengali books that attempted to collate, preserve, and represent a canon inclusive of medieval and early modern texts and poets to the Bengali reading public had started from Ishwar Gupta's own series of the one that I just mentioned, Kobi Jiboni, to a range of writers who then began to put together a canon of Bengali literature for the Bengali reader. So, subsequent to Ishwar Gupta, Horishchandra Mitra wrote Kobi Kolap in 1866. And you must remember, just as an aside, that poetry, of course, is the most important literary genre in the 19th century, hence the emphasis on Kobita, Kobi, the emphasis on poetry. So, after Kobi Kolap 1866, there is Horimohan Mukhopadhyay with Kobi Chorit in 1869, Mahendranath Chattopadhyay with Bongo Bhasha Ritihash in 1871, Ramgoti Nayaratno with Bangla Bhasha O Bangla Shahitya Bishoyak Prostav 1872, Rajnarayan Boshu Bangla Bhasha O Shahitya Bishoyak Bhaktita 1876, Gangacharan Sarkar Bongo Shahitya O Bongo Bhasha 1880, and his son Akkhachandra Sarkar Sharadacharan and Borodakantra Mitra with Prachin Kabbo Shangraha, which was published serially from 1874 to 1877. All of these continued in the same line. Basically, they are putting together a canon of Bengali poetry, Bengali literature over the course of the late 19th century. A number of highly lauded publications appeared at this time, as I'm trying to show. Following this, of course, there was also the drive to collect and preserve the old manuscripts of Bengal. So these are people who are writing and constructing the canon in print, the canon in print publications. But there was also, of course, the attempt to go and find manuscripts from the villages themselves. So the drive to collect and preserve the old manuscripts of Bengal gathered its greatest impetus under scholars such as Horoprasad Shastri and Rajendra Lal Mitra, and institutions such as the Bongiyo Sahitya Parishad. The two greatest icons of this drive, of course, remain Dinesh Chandra Sen and Abdul Karim, both of whom came into prominence around the turn of the century. It was Dinesh Chandra Sen, though, who denounced foreign influence wherever he had found it in Bengali literature the most vehemently, whether in the Persian inflections of 18th century literature or even more so in what he described as the vile predilection of the newly educated classes of Bengal for English literature at the expense of their own inheritance. Such grumblings were not unique to him alone, of course, in this period, but occasionally informed the criticism also of writers stretching from Bankim Chandra to Rabindranath, as they eclectically searched for something they could call their own in their own tradition. But Dinesh Chandra Sen was decrying foreign influence, certainly the most consistently, the most vehemently, and crucially, the most authoritatively, from within the context of his establishment in the academy, which he joined in the Bengali department at Calcutta University as a reader in 1909. And he remained associated with the university, of course, for many a long year, right up till 1932. When Dinesh Chandra published the History of Bengali Language and Literature in 1911, in a remarkable section called A New Ideal in the Country, he held forth on what he called the descent of Bengali culture from the lofty ideals of Hindu spiritualism to the materialist culture of European civilization. Taking unproblematically for granted some essential category he defined as the Bengali race, he maintained that the literature of the Bengali race may be comparatively small in scope, but, I quote him, within its narrow limits, it is deeper and purer than one could expect from a literature covering a wider range. Erratic punctuation and breathless hyphenation attend the long and convoluted passage that followed, and I'm quoting from him here. From home to the world, it was a descent from the Himalayas to the plains, from the great example of Bhishma and Ram, cherished in the heart of every Hindu, the loftiest like the loftiest peak of the Himalayas, to the stories of Duval's assiduity in learning and Sir Philip Sidney's offering his cup of water to the dying soldier. These are instances I think he's quoting from the English texts, the English readers sort of prescribed English teaching at the time in 19th century Bengal. From there, from the pursuit and acquisition of yoga to the knowledge of geographical catechism, to be able to point out Popocatepetl on a map of the globe, from the celestial songs of Radha and Krishna, which, while gratifying all our yearnings for the loftiest of human love, have kept a door constantly open heavenward, to the stories of Paul and Virginia or of Aeneas and Dido, the descent is as great as one from the Himalayas to the plains. From home to the world, Dineshchandra is accurate in his understanding that the 19th century Bengali cultural sphere was essentially an amalgam of the East and West and rooted in the world. But his perception of it as a descent from lofty Hindu spirituality to the materialism of the Western world came from a feeling of degradation that was an essential component of the nationalist thought of the time. Consequently, there was a striving to carve out an impossible separate sphere of communal achievement and valor by constituting a domain comprising a past inheritance that was untainted by colonial rule. That would, in Aurobindo Ghosh's words at the time, quote, found a new and victorious art, literature, science, and philosophy, which will not be European, but Indian, unquote. Yet, practitioners of culture, however much they strained, like Dineshchandra Sen did, to imagine a pure spiritual past, still all themselves materially flourished in the crossbreeding engendered by colonial rule in an unavoidable cosmopolitanism of contact. So what I'm basically arguing is that Dineshchandra Sen himself is a product of a certain cosmopolitanism of contact, although he himself is arguing for a certain idea of purity and authenticity, which I have maintained in my book is impossible to actually achieve at any point in any culture. Dineshchandra affirms, against the grain of the cosmopolitan culture that he himself inhabits, that culture takes root in unmediated identity. Inasmuch as we speak one native language, we belong to a specific cultural world of one self, one language, opting for a fixed relation of force within one group or one state, in surrender to the temptation of unity identity. The term unity identity is taken from Blachot. Maurice Blachot. In this moment around 1900, when in any major world metropolis, ethnographic self-fashioning allowed the self to be culturally constituted as one might choose. So to take some random examples, as Conrad, for instance, chose to be an English writer, although of course he was Polish, as we know. Or a century before that in Calcutta itself, the Portuguese Antony Firingi had chosen to be a Bengali singer-songwriter. Dineshchandra Sen, rather than seeing that, sees instead that the individual is bound up in one culture alone. Such a reading of culture is inalienably tied up, of course, with a robust invocation of nationalist purpose. In his introduction to the first edition of Bongo Bhasha o Sahitya, Dineshchandra ends, appropriately enough, considering that one of the origins of the powerful link between nation and literature lies in Herder's and his followers' contribution to German nationalist historiography, with a quotation from Max Müller. I'm quoting Dineshchandra quoting Max Müller. Finally, we conclude our introduction, Dineshchandra said, with a few words here from Max Müller's invaluable thoughts. And he quotes from Max Müller here. We have to accept that the country in which its people do not feel pride when they contemplate their own ancient history and ancient literature have been deprived of the most important support to their national culture. When the German nation had fallen into the deepest schism of political decline, then the people of that country had applied themselves to the task of discussing their country's ancient literature, and from their reading of their ancient literature, they inculcated a new hope of future progress. What such a quotation reminds us in the context of world literature is that the categorical construction of the domain of literature had been undertaken the world over in the era of nation formation. So what I'm trying to say again and again is that Bengal or India or Indian literature is no different in that sense, chronologically speaking, or in the sense of cultural formation, different from anywhere else in the world, as a matter of fact. If, therefore, extending what Benedict Anderson has shown with regard to the novel and newspaper in the era of print capitalism and its role in imagining the nation, we can turn the lens around toward the construction of the very category of the literary the world over in this period, it might be possible to show that what happened in colonial Calcutta and by extension in colonial India was not so different in time and scale from similar developments the world over. Rather than understand the formation of literary canons and conventions in colonial India as the consequence of the colonial Macaulayan imposition of the English language from above, it may be possible then to conceptualize the birth of world literature the world over as the result of the unavoidable pressures of modernity and colonial contact. Undoubtedly, for instance, Goethe's conversations with Eckermann about world literature were facilitated by publications enabled by British and French colonial conquest, engendering an understanding of world literary production such as had not existed in the century before, existing side by side with Herder's understanding of the folk and the reconstruction of the German ancient canon that Max Müller spoke of, that I just quoted for you. What has not been acknowledged so far, however, is that this parallel stream of world and nation, both these streams, world and nation, are coming together to constitute both world literature and national literatures in Europe and elsewhere, like in India, was similar to developments in India in the 19th century, notwithstanding the fact that it was the violence of colonial imposition that brought these currents to the subcontinent's shores. And nowhere, I must emphasize, am I denying the violence of colonial imposition. Nevertheless, Bankim Chandra said of the coming of modernity, I quote, "And with this new dawn of life came into the country one of the mightiest instruments of civilization, the printing press." He correctly identifies, therefore, we see the power of what Anderson would later call print capitalism as the driving force of community formation. Describing it, Bankim Chandra describes it as a new dawn of life. Dinesh Chandra, on the other hand, just a few years later, but at the start of the 20th century, at the end of the 19th century, speaks of how Bengalis, quote, "forgot their wonderful success in metaphysical learning and their great spirituality and felt that they were dwarfed in the presence of that great materialistic civilization, which armed with thunder and lightning and with the tremendous power of steam stood knocking at their door demanding audience," unquote. He too invoked the material power of the modern. And of course, he's speaking about the colonial presence in India. But he identifies it entirely with the violence of colonial rule rather than as an instrument to be gladly appropriate, as Bankim had done. What I'm trying to show is that both are equally valid sort of categories in order to understand the literary sphere. The welcoming of the world into literary formation by the great writer stood parallel to the rejection of the world in the construction of a pure literary past by the nationalist literary historian. The allegiance to world literature having always existed in some tension with the overpowering nationalist sentimentality about the mother tongue and its autochthonous productions. So I've come now to the conclusion of the talk, and I won't take more than another 5 minutes at the most. In conclusion, I would like to say that the problematic notions of territoriality that mark any examination in India of a writer's sources had, by the time of Ramanujan, so over here I'm speaking of E.K. Ramanujan. Yes?
Excuse me, madam.
Yes?
Not being properly audible. We can't hear you properly.
Okay, I'll join my phone in that case. I don't know why this. Yeah, I'll join my phone. That'll be better.
For the last couple of minutes, we have not been able to listen to you.
But
properly.
It is all right with us, sir.
So should I change my network or not? Because that will mean that I'll go off and come back again. I have only a few minutes left.
I don't think, ma'am, to continue with the present network.
Should I continue?
Yes, ma'am. Please continue.
Professor Bhattacharya, is that okay?
Hello.
Perhaps Professor Bhattacharya can't hear me?
Yeah.
Is it okay now? Should I continue?
Yes, ma'am. Please continue, please.
Okay.
It's not. You are not properly audible.
So what? Okay, then let me just, if Professor Bhattacharya can't hear me, I think it's better that I just quickly.
I think the problem is with AB sir's network, Amit sir's network, sir.
Oh,
I
see.
Not facing so any then.
Okay.
Vivek, can you hear her?
Yes, sir, properly.
Okay.
Okay, Professor Bhattacharya, it seems to be something at your end rather than my end. All the comments also are saying that they can hear. And since I have only 5 minutes left, then let me not sort of, you know, go off screen right now. I'll just quickly conclude. So I wanted to conclude by, in fact, coming into the present. Is that all right? Should I continue? Yeah. So I was speaking about the problematic notions of territoriality that mark any examination in India of a writer's sources. By now, I'm speaking of the present now. And now, in fact, includes also the time of A.K. Ramanujan, the poet, has been displaced from the arena of vernacular literatures to that of Indian writing in English. The defense, however, sounds remarkably similar right up to the present day. The bilingual Kannada poet A.K. Ramanujan defended the Indian writer's multicultural provenance in 1987 by asserting, and I'm quoting, "After the 19th century, no significant Indian writer lacks any of the three traditions, the regional mother tongue, the pan-Indian, which is the Sanskritic Perso-Arabic, and the Western, mostly English. Poetic," he says, not necessarily scholarly assimilation of all these three resources in various individual ways, seems," he said, "indispensable," unquote. Even late into the 20th century, Ramanujan's position was a defense in the face of critics in the same nativist nationalist lineage. Only the partly understandable worry of literary critics in an era of national struggle against colonialism had now been displaced into an attack more particularly on the global provenance of Indian writing in English. Thus, Vikram Chandra, accused by Meenakshi Mukherjee of selling Indianness to the West, a commonplace charge in India since the 1990s, retorted that, I quote him, "This anxiety about the anxiety of Indianness was one that he constantly heard, quote, in conversations and critical texts and reviews. And Indians who wrote in English were one of the prime locations for this rhetoric to test itself, to make its declarations of power and belonging, to announce its possession of certain territories and its right to delineate lines of control," unquote. In his justification, Chandra then went on to quote from Borges's seminal essay, The Argentine Writer and Tradition, concluding that what the exhaustively cosmopolitan and erudite Borges is arguing for in this essay is for, quote, the freedom of artists to choose their own tropes from wherever they see fit. Borges wrote, "What is Argentine tradition? I believe that this question poses no problem and can be easily answered. I believe that our tradition is the whole of Western culture. And I also believe that we have a right to this tradition, a greater right than that which the inhabitants of one Western nation or another may have," unquote. So that was Vikram Chandra quoting Borges. I will conclude by saying that the Indian appropriation of the canon of world literature has a similar relationship to Borges's in the relationship of modern Indian writers have had with the European canon since at least 1850. And appropriation of the scene of the implementation of colonial educational policy to suit their own ends in the 19th century, as they said, if you remember what I began with, to take that which they found good and liked best, resulted in a refashioning of the regional languages of India, including English, I will include English as a regional language of India, into powerful modern literatures that were emblematic of the larger career of the modern in India. Incorporating from the start a mix of heterogeneous influences and unapologetic about its graft of a variety of cultural inheritances, including its own rich classical and folk and popular traditions, modern Indian writing entered the world literature canon a while ago. The question remains, how many have any awareness of this entry? Thank you very much. Thank you. So I hope I'm within time over there.
Is Amida here or? Actually, I also couldn't hear you very well, ma'am, in the last. Anyway, so the.
Maybe we can take it up and.
So what we usually do is we take up questions at the end of the session. So I would ask the participant type down their questions in the chat box. Nandinidhi has raised a hand. Nandinidhi, please go ahead.
Yeah, I'm not typing out the question. Rossinger, but
no, not at all. Don't worry.
Yeah, I'll just say what I wanted to say, and that is, when we have something like in 1823, essays which are collated, which were originally published in Friend of India, and you have the essay on the effect of print on Bengal, the one line of argument which has been taken over later by people like Koff and anybody who has worked on orientalizing influences on Bengal is that there was a greater violence of Sanskritists and a greater violence of Perso-Arabists on Sanskritists. So the British intervention is not the first violence, but in fact it democratizes and produces the vernacular which otherwise would have been violently shoved away by the Sanskritists, who called it apobhasha, good for women and demons. So your take on that.
Sure. Thank you for a very interesting question. So I would be very grateful, in fact, if you could later, maybe by email or however, sort of send me exact reference for the essays in Friend of India. But with regard to what they're saying over there, that is something that, of course, has been, with regard to the fact that the Sanskritic tradition or the Perso-Arabic tradition, greater violence, this notion that, the example that I like to quote above any other is that of the poet Bharatchandra. Annada Mughal was published in 1752. Bharatchandra died by 1760. Bharatchandra is dead. But his language, if you remember, of course, as you know, I'm sure, was described as Jaboni Mishal. Why? Because he used too many, Perso-Arabic words. And therefore, he was attacked for it in his own time, not just later, but in his own time. And if you remember again, he defended it by saying that I would like to bring whatever language I wish to bring into my own poetry. And I think the phrase in his own words is Otoeb Kohi Bhasha Jaboni Mishal. So Jaboni Mishal is his own phrase for that. So exactly. That is exactly the point what you are calling a greater violence. I don't know the context of these specific essays in Friends of India, but that is exactly the point I'm making in the literary thing as well, that there is no such thing when it comes to the poetic sphere as authentic or pure in that sense. It reminds me again of what of Daniel Defoe's poem on the English one, of a mixture of various things began that heterogeneous thing, an Englishman. This is there in the epigraph, I think, to Benedict Anderson's sort of Imagined Communities. But whichever culture we are looking at, whether we are looking at English culture in the 1600s as Defoe was, or whether we're looking at Indian culture in the time of Bharatchandra in the 1700s, no culture at any time is authentic or pure in that sense. It is always, and writers themselves, that's what I tried to come to towards the end of the essay, have always defended their provenance to take from wherever they feel that they would like to take from. So then it is always an impure in that sense, and a worldly inheritance that they take from. So, no, thank you very much for that question. And I look forward to that.
Yes, of course. And just to add that, neither Koff nor Elric, whose dissertation came from Harvard in 20, none of them, neither Rocher nor Telcher, they actually admit to this Anglo-American strain of politics, I mean, literary politics, that the techno-state of printing and the techno-state of of British intervention, of colonial, pre-early modern, actually created the vernacular and made it more democratic. That was their
stance. Yeah,
so, I mean, I found a 20 dissertation that quotes all of this, but not Friend of India. So anyway, thank you. I mean, I've already taken a lot of time.
No, thank you so much. Thank you for your question. But yeah, you got exactly to the point that I was making throughout, which is that, of course, you know, the modern Indian languages, and it is such a wonderful sort of, you know, creation. Every language in India has this amazingly powerful vernacular literature or regional literature, whatever you want to call it. But the fact that it was enabled and created by this, you know, amalgam of influences pouring in from, you know, with the coming of modernity, it's usually not discussed in that way. So, yeah, thank you for your
thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Professor Nandini Bhattacharya and Roshinka Chaudhary, ma'am, for answering this. There are a couple of questions already in the chat box. I'll just read this out once to you, ma'am. Shubham Dotto is asking you, thank you, ma'am, for such a brilliant lecture. The discourse you have situated your talk in is marked by a typical engendering of the nation space. So his question is how Bengali women writers were responding to this national cosmopolitan interface.
Thank you for that question. It's so in response, I will sort of go to poet who is a particular favorite of mine, Toru Dutto, for instance. You will see if you look at the writing of Toru Dutto that Toru is both inhabiting this what you're calling the nation space. She's certainly engendering that nation space by her own presence in it. She's writing, as you know, a book called that was posthumously published called The Ancient Ballads and Legends of Hindustan. So the very fact that she's writing a book that is later titled, she's doing that after learning Sanskrit. She didn't know Sanskrit. She came back to Calcutta and she began to learn it. And then she reinterpreted these stories, and in a sense, by her literary productions, engendered, as you're saying, the nation space with her writings in a certain way. But again, that is why I particularly took the example of Toru Dutto. You will see that it is impossible to separate out or create for Toru Dutto any literary inheritance that is exclusive of any other. She is translating from French poetry with her sister Oru Dutto in A Sheaf Gleaned in French Fields. Remarkable and wonderful translations feated by Edmund Gosse, as you know. She's taking from every language that she reads and also from languages in translation as is available to her in French and English. She's even taking from the Spanish. She's writing in response to all these world languages. So there is no question that she's engendering the nation space if you want to think of women writers as writers who engender the nation space. But it is not only a national space that she is thinking of. It is only later critics and a certain strain of later readers and their responses, as Nandini in fact just pointed out, who tend to create this flow, this unilinear sort of, you know, construction of a national space that is engendered by certain Indian women writers who then sing the nation, if you want to put it like that, to use a phrase that Gayatri Spivak used for one of her book titles. I would argue rather that a writer like Toru Dutto is engendering not just the nation space, but also world literature itself. She is a world writer. She's not just an Indian writer. She's both an Indian writer and a world writer. So that's why I spoke both of two streams. If you remember in the talk, I spoke of one stream that is the world and one stream that is the nation. And these two streams come together to create this category called literature that we understand as literature in more or less the same time at around 1850 in almost all the countries of the world. And here I will include England, and that is something that we can talk further about. That's a very interesting thought if you follow that thought up. But so that's what I would say in response to that question. Thank you for your question.
Yes, thank you, ma'am. Nobida Anjum's question comes next. She's asking if post-colonial literatures would not have, you know, or would have existed at all if the colonial imposition of English was not there. So how would you
So that's a, again, a very interesting sort of question. It's like a counterfactual. I would say to you that even if the colonial education system had not in their academic curriculum taught us all these English poets, I would still say to you that with the coming of modernity, with the coming of the steamship, with the coming of the printing press, and of course, always, and not to undermine that, also with the violent presence of the British in India, there is no question that I'm for a single moment undermining the violence of the colonial project. Please do not take anything of what I've said as a defense of colonial imposition. But I will say to you, so since you've asked me to imagine a situation where the colonial education system and the academic curriculum is not bringing these texts to us, then would the emergence of post-colonial literature have been possible? My understanding is that yes, it would still have been possible. It would have been possible in the same way that it was made possible in China. China was never colonized. Why China? Take the case of Thailand. These are, take the case of instances of countries that have not been colonized. Did they not then generate post-colonial literatures of their own, or in their case, if they were not colonized, not post-colonial, but modern literature? So perhaps if we let go of the term post-colonial and stop thinking constantly in terms of once we were colonized, then we were not colonized, and rather think of modernity and the coming of modernity and the imprints, the instruments of modernity, the printing press itself. So at some point or the other, the printing press would have arrived. If once it arrived, the different, and also very importantly, remember that before the British were here, the Dutch were here, the Danes were here, the Portuguese were here, on the shores of the Hooghly in Bengal, these were the languages already present in small enclaves, the Danish in Srirampur. In fact, these were small enclaves, but they were here. And in fact, it is these spaces of freedom, as I've called them elsewhere in another talk, that allowed the printing press to be used for the objectives that they were used for. We celebrate Carey Marshman and Ward. William Carey is described as the, you know, progenitor of the Bengali language in print, in prose, because of his printing press in Srirampur. But these spaces were also important. So yes, short answer to the question, yes, I think that it would have been possible.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Because you know, we have to stop, or we have to, you know, move beyond thinking the post-colonial as post, as in after, and imagine other forms of power that were, you know, nevertheless there. The next question is from Shayon Barial. Both Nobida and Shayon are our students, ex-students. Shayon is asking you about the new education policy, which has somewhat demoted the status of English by giving privilege to Hindi. Do you find Macaulay's presence still somewhere here?
So I will not say very much about the national education policy, because it needs to be read very carefully, and it needs to be seen whether it is in what manner it is implemented, really. I went to the national education policy on the web, and I went to the section that says what you're saying, you know, and I could not actually see. In fact, it made me worried about what would happen to the regional languages, because it seemed to me that they were not, in fact, because they, I think there is a choice involved, and if there is a choice involved, then it remains to be seen how much English will eventually in the end be demoted, or whether in fact in the end what ends up getting demoted are the regional languages themselves. So I would be careful there. I would ask you to go to the NEP and read it very carefully, and especially in relation to what you're saying in relation to the regional languages of India and its teaching, and you will see that it is quite ambiguous in its wording, and it will remain it remains to be seen how this is implemented and what happens after its implementation to get a sense of what happens really with vis-a-vis regional languages and the English medium. I would like to say to you though, from my own scholarship in 19th century studies, that and my own personal experience actually that it is in it was in the this is what I've said in the talk itself as well, that it was in the colonial era when English was supposedly imposed upon us that the regional languages flourished the most. Bengali was at its most powerful and most beautiful at this time, during when the colonial education policy was forcing them apparently to learn the English language. In fact, I am saying to you that the English language facilitated the creation of Bengali language, Tamil language, Odia language, literature. It facilitated it. Now in the post-colonial situation, I will ask you the question that from the, if you compare someone who was educated in the 1950s, if you know anyone in your grandparents' generation, and you compare it to anybody of your own compatriots and coevals who have been educated in the current system, I will say to you that nowadays we know no language at all. We don't know English properly. We don't know Bengali or Oriya or Hindi properly. We do not give any importance to language or the language learning or literature, and we do not do that because as such the humanities itself is undervalued. The humanities has no value to the current dispensation or the previous dispensations that have been in power in India, and now it is more and more manifesting itself worldwide. And if you denigrate the humanities, this is what will happen. People will forget not only English, they will forget their own languages as well. And I think in fact that it is the regional languages that have suffered the most. I find very few of my students know Bengali as well as they should. We read a lot of Bangla scripts in our institute, and I'm sorry to say none of them write Bengali at the standard at which my own grandfather would have written it in the 1960s. So that's just putting that out there. But yeah.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Another question has come from Priyanka, but before that I would like to ask one question maybe. I am Shomibendra Banerjee from the Department of English, University of Gorbongo. My interest of late has been in the 19th century Bengali theater, the emergence of the public theater, for example. So how would you look at this in the context of theater? Because when we talk of modernity in theater, we say that it is of course something that we learned from the English theaters, the colonial in the colonial cities that laid on to our proscenium stages. So would you see this also as an example of world literature emerging through English in Bengal? And also, where do you place a text like, say, Neil Dorpon here, where there are so many other formations associated with Neil Dorpon, with English, with Madhusudan in getting involved, etc. If you can just comment on this, please.
So really, actually, all one needs to do, Shomipendra, is look at history. I mean, if you just turn back to the archives, and or even to taking a look at secondary sources that deal with the coming of the proscenium theatre and modern Bengali theatre in Bengal, the first name that will be quoted back at you almost immediately is Lebedev. Lebedev was Russian. Lebedev came and established a commercial theatre. It was the first so-called Bengali theatre, in the sense that it was performed in Bengali with a lot of song, of course, yes. Present in it, but again, if we are to see Lebedev as one of the first originators of modern Bengali theater, then that is there. That is the world, you know, present right there in the 1790s in Calcutta. Following that, if you were to look at the Belgachia theater and the manner in which Michael Madhusudan Dutta was commissioned to write a few decent Bengali plays, as they termed it, by the Tagores. Then again, you will see how Madhusudan turned to, you know, and I just quoted from his reading to you, turned to his knowledge of, you know, Greek, Roman, English. He was, you know, well-trained in all of these world languages and literatures. And from there, he created the first two farces, Eke Ki Bole Shubhota, and
Buro Shalikir Gharero.
So again, there is the world for you. There is world literature right at the inception of Bengali theatre in Calcutta. So really, I don't need to go on giving you examples. Look at Girish Ghosh himself, for instance. Girish Ghosh's contribution to will be seen to be inflected with a variety of influences from the world literature, from the world canon. That was brought to his doorstep in colonial Calcutta by the forces of colonialism, maybe the forces of modernity, maybe whatever you want to call it. But it will be impossible for you to say that Bengali literature began and flourished, and that is modern Bengali, modern Bengali theatre began and flourished and continued in a purely authentic Bengali strain. I mean, it would actually not be possible to say such a thing. Wouldn't you agree?
Yes, very much. Okay, thank you, ma'am. We will go to can we take one last question, please?
I can see Jatin over here. I saw Jatin briefly for a couple of seconds. Hi, Jatin. I suddenly saw your face. Good to see you after such a long time. Yeah, I thought you would have something to say about Oriya literature. You're muted. No, I think I think you need to unmute yourself.
Okay. No, I joined in the middle of your, I think, when your talk ended, because I got the information rather late.
You know that I have been saying the same thing for a long time. So.
No. You have that. But you give it a new perspective whenever you talk about it. So it's wonderful listening to you. So. Good.
Anyway, it's good to see you here. But yeah, so Jatin has worked extensively in the field of Oriya literature and the manner in which Oriya literature, especially in the 19th century and how it began. And when I was looking at 19th century poets in the literary thing, I was also surprised to see how Rangulal Bandyopadhyay had been stationed in Cuttack, and how he then learned Oriya and translated from the Oriya. So really, even in the formation of Oriya language and literature, as it came into existence from the 19th century onward, I mean, the world is there, present in Cuttack or in Sambalpur or wherever you are in Orissa, where literary production is happening, whether in the time of Jayanta Mohapatra, which is now. But how is he, by the way? How is...
He's fine on the whole. He's... considering his age, he's doing quite well. In fact, I interviewed him at the Indian Express Literature Festival 1 year ago, and he was doing very well.
Oh, I see. Okay. You should have alerted us. I didn't see that.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, I can send you the YouTube.
Please do. So, I'm always interested in him. Please send him my regards.
So you will have a glimpse of Jayanta Mahapatra, is doing very well at the age of 92. So
very
lonely, but otherwise absolutely fine.
Sure. Yeah. So to come back to the discussion, basically, I mean, you know, world literature in the context of Oriya literature is happening as much in the case of Rangulal Bandyopadhyay as in the case of Jayanta Mahapatra, you know. So that's why I drew that trajectory from the past to the present to show that it is a continuing thing, this interest that writers have in writers from all over the world, wherever they take inspiration from, they just take it like magpies rather than worry or bother about national affiliations and national space. And that is a very academic and post-colonial studies sort of, you know, imperative. Writers themselves will almost never speak of sort of, you know, national literature or national influence in that way.
Yes, ma'am. Can we take another last question? I mean, one last question, actually.
Sure.
Yeah, okay. So I'll just read this out. Let me find this. Yeah, so Priyanka Chatterjee is asking, there was a tendency to separate spheres of Bengali literature into, on the one hand, Bhadralok literature and, say, Bhattola literature. So how do you think the differentiation or the amalgamation, if at all, might have contributed in the making of the Indian stream of world literature? Or the other way around?
Thank you for that question. That's a very interesting question. I'll point you, in fact, to a very interesting essay by Gautam Bhadra in Abhubhash that I have quoted from in my book, where he shows you, in fact, by quoting from Bankim Chandra, of all people, how it is impossible to separate the world of the Bhattola from the world of the Bhadralok. They do not, in fact, he takes issue with Sumanta Banerjee and with the parlor and the street, as Sumanta Banerjee put it in the title of his book. And he says there was no separate parlor and there was no separate street. The sounds of the street came into the parlor and the parlor went into the street. And it is actually a combined sort of cultural sphere. No sphere, in a sense of what he says over there, so can be used in extenuation in extension of what I'm saying over here, that no sphere extends or exists authentically in a separate space of its own. So Bhattola literature is very much on in the consciousness of Bankim Chandra when he's describing, for instance, the beauty of Ashmani. He says in a passage where he's describing the beauty of Ashmani that Saraswati Devi, tumi amar ghat theke namo. I'm just paraphrasing, but you know, let me turn instead to the Bhattola, and he then evokes many much of the Bhattola literature of that time, which he needs in order to describe her beauty, he says. So basically, but the theoretical point that Gautam Bhadra is making there is one that I have also quoted him for, which is the point that I am making as well, that it is impossible to not only separate the cultural sphere out into nationalist spaces and world, sort of, you know, and colonial spaces in that way. It is also impossible to therefore separate a creative sphere into Bhadralok literature and Bhattola literature. The venues of print and publication may be different. Yes, Bhattola literature happened in pamphlet form. It happened in it sold far more copies, of course, of Bhattola literature. And it may have dealt in scandal and gossip, apart from printing almanacs. Printing almanacs was what it primarily did. In the form of printed almanacs, in fact, the Bhattola publication reached every single Bengali Hindu Bhadralok's home. So it is impossible to separate out the two spheres in that way. And they should not be separated out when you're thinking of the making of the Indian stream of world literature, as you say. I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, I think so. There are no other questions as of now. I think we have come to an end to this question answer session. Thank you, Rushinka ma'am, for being, you know, so patiently answering all these questions. And it has been such an illuminating lecture for me. I mean, there were so many several strands, starting from pedagogy. We couldn't really talk about the points that you raised about Gauri Vishwanathan, because that was another way of, you know, another part of your talk. Anyway, I would request Professor Amit Bhattacharya to conclude the session.
Thanks Amit very much. Yeah.
I hope I am audible now.
Yes.
I hope there are no network issues. I'm extremely sorry. The fault was in my network, you know, and I was the loser because I couldn't listen to the last part of the lecture because of some network issues. But after that, I have listened to the Q&A session. So thank you, Professor Chaudhary, for such a insightful presentation and for being so patient and so erudite in your answers to the questions that were raised. Now, when you were discussing the the crossover between the Bartola and the Bhadralok literatures. You know, I was reminded of Tineth Talwar by Utpal Dutt while reconstructing the Bengali stage in the late 19th century. He was really trying to talk about this particular amalgamation. So when he was talking about the Jelepara's song, and he was also talking about certain very Sanskritized theater productions and all that. So Krishnakanta's wheel was also very, very much there. So thank you for this presentation, and but the fun does not end here. After thanking Professor Rozinka Chaudhary, I must also tell the audience that the Parle 2021 continues. On the 4th, we have another lecture. Then Dr. Tarun Pradhan from Rabindra Bharati University, the Department of Drama, is going to talk about folk theatre, its heritage and its trajectory of development. So I would like to invite all of you to be with us then also. With this, we come to the end of this session. I must, on behalf of the department, on behalf of the audience, and on my behalf as well, thank Professor Chaudhary for being with us and sharing with us her extraordinary scholarship in 19th century studies. I was especially thankful to you, and I am thankful to you for connecting the canon of world literature and how it inversely helped in the making of Bengali literature and its canon as well. Thank you, ma'am. With this, we have to call it a day, because every good thing has to end somewhere.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much, Professor Bhattacharya, for the invitation to speak to you. Thank you, and I hope that we remain in touch in some way or the other.
Of course. We'd love to hear from you in future.
Thank you very much. Especially,
we would love to hear about Professor Chaudhary, the critic as Roshik, at a future time.
Surely. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
For having me. Thank you.